This is the Literary License Podcast. 2-for-1 episode coming at you from the UK and USA with your hosts, John Wilson, Vicky Ray, and Keith Chorgo, discussing films that change your life from comedy to horror and everything in between.
Shiloh? Is your name Shiloh? Can I talk to you? Can you come down, please? So we can speak. I saw you at the show. I thought I'd seen a ghost. Your resemblance is striking. You have your mother's eyes, her hair. I was told you died with her. All these years have come and gone. How do I put this? I'm your godmom.
State your business.
Business?
What do you want?
I want to finally meet you. Something real to cling to, leave you with the hope that you will go to all you're meant to, all I failed to. In you is a world of promise. We have both been kept in bondage, but you can learn from all my failures.
I'm not supposed to talk to strangers.
Or let them through the gate.
That either. A big risk.
A big fence.
A mistake.
A new friend.
How'd you do that?
Do what?
Do that. That I think.
These eyes can do more than see.
I know. I mean, I've seen you sing.
Where?
From my window. I can see the world from there. Name stars and constellations, count the cards and watch the seasons.
I wish we could have watched together.
I can't have guests.
Never?
Ever. If Dad found out that I'd been let out or that you'd been let in.
I should go then before I do. Promise me you won't.
Better that you don't.
Don't forget me. Sheltered rose.
Best of
all. Room
zoom.
To bloom outside my bedroom. Integrity, honesty, it's too late for me. Don't look back till you're free to chase the morning. Hi, Nathan.
Meg, how did you get in here? Don't you have a show tonight?
How are you, Nathan?
Busy.
You never were a man of many words, Nate. You told me Shiloh died.
Listen.
Nathan, I promised your late wife I'd be present in Shiloh's life.
Please, Meg. Shiloh's very ill. It's not safe for her to see people. I need to give her medication.
Dad, let her stay in here.
No, she's leaving.
Please hide her here.
From what?
She'll be dead.
Look, I told her she was sick.
Nathan, you are hurting me.
Dad!
My daughter needs a rest.
I'll be fine, hey. Shiloh, don't you fret. Repossessions
Shiloh,
are dangerous. You're not safe.
Shiloh,
Dad,
don't
she's
you
not
fret.
Safe.
It's your bedtime. It's late.
Stop,
it's late.
She will die.
Nonsense.
It's a ride, Dad.
Nonsense.
It's a contract.
A contract.
Come and see.
Nonsense.
Come see. Max in trouble, Dad.
Where'd you get this?
Read it, Dad. A repo man will come and take Max's eyes.
There are things in life that we do best to leave alone.
She'll die, you must help her die. She'll die, you must stop her die.
That you don't want to know.
Will you save back? She will lose her rights unless you stop this Repo Man.
Shiloh, this is senseless.
Dad, you have to try.
This is pointless.
Shiloh,
please shut up.
It's Christmas Eve. All who believe Santa is here. But once a year, all girls and boys dream of new toys. Soundly they sleep. Wishes to keep. Jing, jingling. Come, hear us sing. Wreaths on the door. Stockings and more. Magic this thrice. Spells come alive. Snow in the air. Laughter to share. Family and friends. Season to cleanse. Joyful and dear. End of the year. Tis a very fine and special Christmas. Tis a very fine and special Christmas. It's Christmas Eve.
Hello, welcome to Literary License Podcast. Today we're discussing Repo, Genetic Opera from 2008 and Devil's Carnival from 2012. And today we have with us John Wilson. Hello, John.
Hello, folks. How are you? Happy holidays.
And Vicky's not with us because Vicky is still gallivanting over the Midwest playing with children, mainly her grandchildren, her grandchild, actually.
Hunting she's down like the, turkeys.
She's like the Pied Piper, probably leading them to their own doom. So before we go any further, let's find out what we've been up to. So John, where have we been up to with you since last time we spoke to you?
Oh, you know, just working my butt off and trying to enjoy the time, you know, the breaks when I get them, but especially the holidays are coming up. And so it's like I find people were celebrating Christmas before Thanksgiving. So I'm assuming by Christmas we'll be celebrating Easter. So
Halloween.
Yeah, exactly. But I've been like trying to catch up on different stuff, but I got Disney Plus. I've been watching Mandalorian. I've been watching Encore, which is a great show. Mandalorian is just fantastic. And I've been just been trying to catch up on like some of the stuff I have in my DVR. Cause you know, it's like you get so busy and all of a sudden before you know it, you have like 18 different shows, you know, with 8 different episodes to watch. So,
well, myself, I've been watching a lot of television on Amazon Prime, which is www.amazon.whereyouare.co.uk or .com or .au if you're in Australia. And finished up, I think Swamp Thing, which is fantastic. Loved it.
I heard that because they pulled the plug after like the second episode, people did not.
They pulled the plug before they even released it.
Yeah.
Because there was, it's done by Warner and it has to do with D DC and Warner, something to do with the contract.
Oh, so they must have had pulled it because of that, right, from a royalties or rights perspective, right?
Yeah, and the thing is, it was excellent. All 10 episodes. I mean, it was gory as hell. And it was scary, had good cast in it. It was had really interesting casting in it. Had Virginia Madsen in it, which she's always very good. And a bunch of faces you recognize. Even had Ian Ziering in it, taking a break from the Sharknado films and Beverly Hills. But yeah, it's excellent. I highly recommend it.
Oh, very cool. Because I wasn't going to watch it. And then I was like, well, you know, I might just watch it because it's probably just going to be like a novella. Like, you'll finish it and be done. So...
Yeah, you should really watch it. I mean, the fans, it's got like a 97% critic rating on it as far as loving it.
Cool.
And I think Rotten Tomatoes is up there as well, as in like the high 90s. So, I mean, who knows? Maybe, you know, they'll come out with another season or something like that if they can get, you know. But then again, when it comes to comic book rights, you know, as you know, with Marvel and DC, they're always a bit of a muddle as far as...
Yeah.
You know, where are we going to go with this? Who's going to do what? And who's going to get the money and who, whatnot.
It's so. Also how far the fans, because the fans could rally, but if it's a rights and royalties thing, then it won't go beyond what the studio wants.
Yeah. So you have that. And you also have, I think with all the different boxes coming out as well, I think that's having an effect on things as well. As you know, like Disney Plus had to put Marvel off all the Netflix and all stuff like that, so they're bringing that back. And
yeah,
you know, so then I think then that end quite a few seasons that were on Netflix because of certain things because of
so all of the Defenders series, so Jessica Jones, Jessica Jones, Luke
Iron
Cage,
Fist,
Iron Fist, which was a horrible show. All those had to be pulled because basically they didn't want to spend more money. The contract was up for renewal. They were like, we're not going to renew because we eventually want to create similar content on the Disney Plus. So,
well, they're having the same problem here with BBC, and the channels over here are getting their own box. They're doing their own Disney Plus kind of thing or their own Netflix kind of thing. And so what's happened there is that, you know, in the next couple of months, everything's going to be pulled. Anything that's that related that Netflix is currently showing is going to be pulled.
Yeah.
They're going to want, you know, but it makes sense because they want you to purchase, you know, these channels and or this box or this whatever. So it does make sense. But unfortunately, it does mean like, you know, when they do pull them, their contracts are with this other company. So what do they do? Because some of these actors might not be there for the new contract. So, so it brings things up in the air. But so I think Swamp Thing got caught up in that. And then I'm getting excited for the new Al Pacino TV series that will be on Amazon Prime as well, which is Hunters.
Oh, very cool. What is that about?
It starts next week. It's about this Jewish mafia hunting down Nazis from World War II. But I think from what I can tell from the trailer, I don't know a lot about it, but it looks very interesting. But what I can tell from the trailer is that it kind of jumps from time to time.
Oh, that's cool.
Because there's some hippie-looking kids in there as well for some reason. Then there's like, and it kind of flips back to today, and then it's so it'll be quite interesting. And then of course Netflix is doing the V Battle, which is a vampire series.
Yeah, I heard that's actually really good. Mm-hmm.
And then tonight I'll finish up my last episode of Heart Songs, the new Dolly Parton series, which is
Want to see that. It looks so good. And I love her anyways, but it's like, it just looks so good.
There's the only thing I'll say about it is that if they feel like TV movies.
Yeah. So they feel very Hallmark, right?
Yeah. They're very, So, and the thing is, I like that kind of stuff, especially during the holiday season. I love those Christmas movies. I watch tons of them because, you know, I do like that part where, you know, you kind of watch it and you're like, you know, you're just kind of enjoying it. You're sitting there with the duvet wrapped around you and maybe a cup of hot chocolate. And then, and then you get to the end and your bottom lip starts to quiver and you're trying not to cry because it's so sickly sweet. It's kind of like that. So, but so far I only got one more to go, and I really enjoyed all of them. There's one I wasn't too sure about, but I still had a lot that I liked about it. So
yeah.
And other than that, nothing else. Just spitting out podcast episodes left, right, and center, so that way they're out and ready before I go away. So So do you have any plans for Christmas?
I'm actually going to go out to Jersey to see some friends. So they invited me out to there, but staying local, you know, working, plugging along, maybe going to see a couple movies. I'm actually, tonight I'm going to go see Dr. Sleep, which I've been dying to see. So
have you read the book?
I did. I loved it. I thought it was great. Yeah.
Because I'm finding with the fans, there seems to be a slight divide because I guess it's a bit like The Shining itself, isn't it? Because you had the book The Shining, and then you had the film The Shining, which are kind of two different beasts kind of in the same universe. And I think in Dr. Sleep, of course, the book is a sequel to the book. Yeah. And I think the movie is the sequel to the film. So,
yeah.
Because, you know, because it's a sequel to the Kubrick's, isn't it? So they kind of like taking the book and like, you know, so I guess that's probably the reason why. But so far, when I know that scene, I really liked it a lot. So
I think there's a confusion because people haven't read the book. So I think from a fan perspective of The Shining, it takes you down a completely different path. And it's more in talking about the gift of The Shining and like what it is and like how there's a whole world there. So I think it kind of opens that up. But if you've never read the book, you're probably a little confused. I found the book really interesting to see how they're going to try to mirror what they did in the film, which it seems like they are when they kind of go back to the Overlook. So there's these moments that kind of like hit all these memories back for Danny, which I'm like really excited about.
Yeah. I mean, another thing is, I guess it's going to be the Overlook, isn't it? Cause the Overlook doesn't get destroyed in the book, but it gets destroyed in it doesn't get destroyed in the film, but gets destroyed in the book. So it'll be interesting when they go back, how they handle that. So, I mean, that's on my list of things to see as well. And of course, for our listeners out there, make sure you see Anna and the Apocalypse, the new musical film that's out on DVD and Blu-ray and available to rent starting on Friday. Tasteless promotion there, sorry people. So I guess that brings us to Repo the Genetic Opera. Now the interesting thing about Repo the Genetic Opera is brought to you from the people who did Saw. It's a 2008 American science fiction gothic rock musical horror film, and of course it's directed by Darren Lynn Bousman, which he did, I think he did Saw 2, 3, 4, maybe 5.
We did a few. I think he did
two through five. And the soundtrack was produced by Japanese rock star Yashisuke. It's based on a 2002 musical of the same name, which was written and composed by Darren Smith and Terrance Zdunich. The film stars Alexa Vega, Paul Sorvino, Anthony Stewart Head, who sounds a lot like his brother Murray Head from Jesus Christ Superstar, and Sarah Brightman, Paris Hilton, who actually does a decent job in this one. That's another surprise.
Yeah.
Bill Moseley, Navik Olger, and Terrence Zdunich. Sorry if I mispronounce your name and massacred. I'm very, very sorry. It did premiere at the Fantasia Film Festival of July of 2008, followed by a very limited release on November 7th, 2008, on several screens in Pasadena, Chicago, Mobile, Charlotte, Kansas City, Toronto, and Ottawa. The film initially received mixed to negative reviews, but gained a cult following similar to the Rocky Horror Picture Show, managing even to fill theaters worldwide with costume fans performing shadow cast versions of the movie, where Smith and Zdunich often visit to meet fans. So, do you have anything you'd like to add to that?
I'm actually shocked because when I think I saw the trailer for this, the trailer doesn't know justice. So I was like, what the hell is Keith making me watch? And then I actually got into it and I think I really enjoyed the stylistics to it, but also, I mean, opera is something that's not easy to consume sometimes, especially if it's full on aria. There are moments where they break and do dialogue, but I was actually, like I said, pleasantly surprised by how this is done. I saw there are some moments that are very much like Hamlet, like Romeo and Juliet, and like for some reason Rapunzel came to mind too, with the character of Shiloh and like her being in her tower and she can't really, you know, talk to anyone and get to know anyone. I mean, sort of separated from the world, but I love the whimsical of it. I love the goth of it, because like, I think you're so used to seeing musicals as being bright and sunny, but this is like very dark and dank, but still somehow able to capture the whimsicalness of all the different characters. So I definitely I really am glad that you suggested this, because again, I watched a trailer and I was like, what is this? And so if you watch a trailer, folks, don't watch it. Just don't watch a trailer. Just watch the movie. Just like going to watch it.
Well, speaking of the trailer, what we're going to do is cut to the trailer now, and we'll be back after this plays.
By the middle of the 21st century, organ failure had become a worldwide epidemic. But GeneCo was there to satisfy the demand for organ replacements. The problem is, if you miss a payment, GeneCo sends out the Repo Man. And when he finds you, your time is up.
Collect on the Handelman account at once. His payment is past due.
Everybody, everybody!
I've become. It's me she must escape. I'm only living out a lie. I'm the monster. I'm the villain. What perfection! What precision! Incisions, I deliver unscathed organs. I deliver repossessions. I deliver the repossessions.
Hello, welcome back to Literary Life's Podcast. We're discussing Repo, the Genetic Opera. Yeah, I mean, to further go on for you, it's one of those films that I thought it'd be quite interesting, because normally around Christmas time, we always trying to find something musical to cover. And I think we did Jesus Christ Superstar in season two, maybe. I think season one, then we do Reefer Madness.
Yeah.
So now I try to find things that are like a bit off-kiltered. Repo, I had seen it once before. I wasn't crazy about it the first time I saw it.
Yeah.
This time around, I actually did like it. I think I like the performances. I like the comic book feel of it. I like the overlooked look of it. And it does, and even though it's called a genetic opera, to me it feels more like Evanescence or Nightwish or one of those gothic rock bands.
Yeah,
because you know, and Within Temptation is another gothic rock band that I quite like a lot, and they do this kind of music where they'll have like this kind of operatic voice going on in the middle while this grunge rock is going on in the background, mm-hmm. And I like the idea that the gore makes sense in this context of this world.
Yes.
So it wasn't just like, okay, well, what we're going to do is we'll just add some gore because, you know, we want to make it horror, so therefore we're just going to add it. They made sure that everything fits within the context of the storytelling, and that's what I quite like about this.
Well, it's a whole change, too. Like, I think it kind of gives in light to our own future, where are we going with mortality and wanting to live forever? And so, you know, we have the cosmetics of the world now, the liposuction and the Botox and all that, but this is to the extreme. And I think it's a very interesting premise to be like, it's almost like the mafia, like we'll give you a healthy kidney because you literally drank yourself to death, or you know, a healthy liver. But if you don't uphold your end, you know, we're going to take it back. But it's that sort of, again, the transformational thing, like you said, the gore to it comes from the Repo Man, but it's also the constant stream of death always around. Like, it's like everywhere. There's bodies literally everywhere. And it's just sort of the norm, because it's like we decompose, we die. But it's that thought of, if you can live forever, the elite sort of have that capability of being like, you know, forever, well, not even forever beautiful, because look at the brother, right? The brother who literally staples a face onto his to constantly look pulled, you know? It's.
Well, I found another thing quite interesting, that if you look in this in the confines of healthcare today, we are living in a fact, I mean, like where I work, people are looking for a quick fix.
Yeah.
And they'll do anything for that quick fix. And they don't want to change their lifestyle. They don't want to change their eating habits. They don't want to change anything. They just want now it's medication.
Yeah. The magic pill or the, yeah.
Yeah. And then you think, you know, and we see it with like people with gout and different things, you know, different diseases and conditions that I deal with on a daily basis, you know, and we kind of do have a little bit of this going on. We don't have organ transplants at the moment going on per se, but we do have, if someone gets overweight, instead of dieting and fixing their lifestyle, they'll get liposuction.
Yeah, or they get a device installed in their body to regulate the...
Yeah. Now, the problems with that basically is that if you get, not lipo, but gastric bypass, for instance, and you don't change your eating habits, what happens is that your body's taking in a third less nutrients than normal. So that means you have to change your diet, which means that everything that you eat has to be more vitamin and mineral enriched.
Yeah.
So if you don't do that, then what tends to happen is you go gray and you start losing your hair. And that seems to be one of the downfalls of gastric bypass that we see where I work anyway.
Wow.
And, but then if you look at, you know, as far as black market, when it does come to people who need like kidneys and organ transplants and what goes on behind the scenes, there's plenty of documentaries out there about that.
Yeah.
That if they, let's sit there and say that there's a farm that had this and they can control this a bit more, how much can they charge? It's like the drug companies, how much can they charge if they own the license on it?
Yeah.
And what happens if you can't pay that license?
Yeah. And I thought that was that's a very interesting premise for this. Like I never, and it's kudos to them for thinking of it from creating, he's a villain, but he's not a villain because he's just kind of doing what has been told of him. And they're also, Nathan Wallace, I'm speaking of, and, you know, obviously spoiler alert, Repo Man. He is someone who's just trying to do right by his daughter, but he's also protecting this huge secret, which technically is a secret that, you know, he thinks he killed his wife, but he really didn't. But it's like one of these things where I think it's interesting that he is not really wanting to be a repo man, but then I feel like there's a bit of a Jekyll and Hyde to him, right? Like, and correct me if I'm wrong, there's moments where you get this character who is just maliciously doing his job, but then there's a part of him that it kind of likes what he's doing. And I think, is it that he doesn't want to do it because he is liking it, or he doesn't want to do it because he doesn't want his daughter to find out? So now it's a new secret, you know?
I think it's, you also have the guilt, isn't it? Because he the wife, the love of his life. And I think that there's that guilt behind it as well. So therefore, when you have that guilt that you might be the cause of your long love or wife in a sense is death, and then someone comes in and basically uses that guilt of yours for their own benefit as well. So he's always torn. But I also found it quite interesting that there is a bit of Munchausen's going on here as well with his daughter to keep her enslaved.
Yeah.
Take your medication, take your pill, you can't leave, you'll die, you'll get this, get that. And he puts this alarm on her in case she has, I guess it's kind of like an asthma attack.
Yeah, blood attack.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, I mean, I wonder if he made her bald, because, like, you know, in the beginning of this, she's bald. Like, she's not, like, so, and I think from that point on, she's always wearing that wig. But I was kind of like, wow, to what extent did he make her believe, like, did he put something to where it makes her hair not grow back or it falls out? I mean, that's, you know, how much, the extent of what you would do for the love of your daughter to keep her safe and to keep her out of that world, you know?
Well, I've seen Dee Dee Blanchard quite a lot.
Yeah. Well, and you know what this made me think of, by the way? It made me think of, what's the recent movie that was, I think it was on Amazon, about the mom who poisons her daughter. And
it's a true story, Dee Dee Blanchard.
Oh, that's,
But it had, what's her name? Arquette. She was Dream Warriors Arquette, that one. Patricia Arquette, there we go. Dream Warriors Arquette. Patricia Arquette. She was fantastic in that. She was unrecognizable. She was brilliant. Even the one that's playing the kid, what was her name? Something Blanchard. I want to say Rosemary.
She was in, I'm trying to think what she was in. She's, yeah, she is fantastic. She's another childhood actress that was in something.
I mean, I watched that series about Munchausen with her. And then I had to watch all these documentaries afterwards. I mean, I find that case fascinating.
But and very similar to this story. That's what
it's with the Munchausens.
That was a big twist for me because I didn't even think that he was doing that. I my thought was that he's just a repo man and that's what he's trying to protect from her knowing. Sorry, my computer just went crazy. What the heck just happened? That was weird. So I just think that was very interesting. Like that, again, this story where he's, what extent would he go to in order to kind of keep his daughter? Cause in my mind, I thought, oh, he's just being very overly protective and he just doesn't want, he wants to shelter her from this world. And like, if she can't go outside, you know, it could kill her. So of course you're going to want her to be like the boy in the bubble, right? You want to keep her in the bubble and keep her safe. At one point too, even the woman, that was the opera singer. What was her name?
Sarah Brightman.
Blind Mag. Blind Mag, I think her, I thought at one point, like, I wonder if that's her, it could have been her mother because it was like, it's her friend. But then there was a part of me that's like, I wonder if it's really her friend or is it actually she was the mother and they faked her death. Like, I was like coming up with all these scenarios because it does kind of keep you guessing. Like, you're learning all these little secrets and especially like the comic book format. I love that's how they do the flashbacks and the sort of the prologue to all of these scenes. And I think it's just brilliant. And I love that part of it. I love that element of where it just kept you guessing with the characters and who they are.
I quite like the, I think Anthony Stewart Head does a really fantastic job in this. I know that we know him from mainly Buffy. I know a lot of people in America didn't know that he could sing. Over here, he's Murray Head's brother. If you don't know who Murray Head is, if you buy the original Jesus Christ Superstar soundtrack, he's the original Judas. That's his brother. And his brother had quite a few pop hits in the late 60s, early 70s. And then, of course, you know, Anthony Stewart Head outside of Buffy, which is known in the American audience, worldwide audience over here. Over here, we had him he played Frankenfurter in Rocky Horror Picture Show here. So, you know, so here we kind of always knew he sang. But I think he does a fantastic job here, though at times he kind of looks like the singing Anthony Hopkins.
Yeah.
There's a very Anthony Hopkins look about him at times. Sometimes it's like, oh my God, he could be like in Silence of the Lambs, the musical.
it's literally, well, and it's like trying to be like cruel, but it's like cruel, but at the same time, like cunning, you know, it's that look. He's got that, yeah.
And I quite like his character because at times it's like, oh my God, he's quite vicious. He does what he has to do and he does it viciously and he does toy with the people when he's grabbing back the organs from these people. Cause I mean, he's cutting them out of them while they're alive because apparently they keep fresh that way. He doesn't kill them and then take them out. He only kills them because, you know, if he has an audience and he's a bit bored, then he tends to kill them really quickly just to get out of the room. Yeah. But then you have like this haunted version of this father who's always trying to do best. And, you know, you kind of got, you know, you got him, you know, slicing up one person and, you know, in his little soliloquy that's, you know, full of hate and damnation. And then you see him like being exasperated with his daughter. And I thought those scenes that kind of bounced off each other. And I have to say for Alexa Vega, I'm kind of a bit of a fan of hers after this. It's like, she pulled it out of the bag. I didn't know she could sing, first of all.
Yeah, I agree. That was interesting that it's like, again, I, for some reason, in my mind, I always see Anthony Head as obviously Buffy the Vampire Slayer, Niles. Yeah. So it's like, I think of when he did, you know, Once More Feeling, the whole like episode where he's singing, it was like, oh my God, that's brought back some memories. I do feel like he was very Jekyll and Hyde. Like he was very, there was even one song and I can't remember which one it was, but it's as if he's talking to himself. He's not talking to himself, but it's like he goes from being like sincere and sweet to being like, oh, like his voice actually even changes. And I thought that was very interesting. But yeah, the girl that played Shiloh, yeah, Alexa is, I'm hoping, because I know they said that they want to do a sequel to this. I'm hoping that they actually would do a sequel to this and have her, where does she go from here? Like, what is her story? Because you really, she's been in a cage her whole life. And so now she's finally broken free. And I guess in some ways now owns that company, Genco. Like, I think it's now hers.
No, I went to Paris Hilton's character, Amber Sweet, because it went up to, because at the end of it, there's an epilogue after the final song goes and it pops back into it. And Amber Sweet, I don't know, it's up for auction or something like that. And the first five bidders, Bill Moseley's character, Luigi, kills them because he has his anger issues. And so for Paris Hilton to raise the money, she sells her face, the one that falls off. And her brother buys it and gives her enough money to take over Genco, and they're going to bring it to a brand new future. But we're not quite sure what that future is going to be, because, I mean, these are three psychotic people.
But so, then I guess it would be, would she be the new sort of, like, hero of the story, that meaning not Shiloh? Because I feel like then the Paris Hilton character, yeah, I think she would be a good villain. Like, she's, you know, just as malicious as her father, and probably a little bit more, what's the word I'm looking for? She's has less empathy for things. She's more driven by the need for to be medicated and need to cut people up. So there's more maliciousness to her than her father was more out of revenge. He was doing what he was doing, and he wanted someone to take the helm because he knew, like, my other thing was, like, did he do that as a way to give the company to Shiloh as a way of, like, trying to get back at Nathan and trying to make it look even worse, like trying to be the would-be dad for her?
See, I think he looks at Shiloh, and he looks at, because we have Nathan, who steals Rati's girlfriend away and marries her.
Yeah.
And they have, and then on the outside, it looks like the perfect marriage.
Yeah.
And then he has his daughter, who's beautiful. And then you see the three children he's produced, who are totally psychotic, messed up every which way and everything like this.
Yeah.
And he knows that he can't trust his great big legacy that he's built to these three. So yeah. In the fact that he figures that this could, if he stayed with Shiloh's mom, this is the daughter that they would have produced.
Yeah, this is what they would have had, yeah.
And, you know, therefore my life would be more picturesque than the idiots that I gave birth to. Though, you know, I love the way they casted this and stuff like this, but if you look at, to put things in more of a realistic setting for the killing, the age of his children are all over the place to where the mother, the Shiloh, because they should probably all be around the same age.
Yeah, I was going to say. So,
yeah. You know, from the backstory that we get.
Or is it that, and my thought was too, is it that he was, like, because it doesn't say that he didn't have these kids. Was he divorced or did his wife die? And then he had an infatuation with her mom. And then she was like, oh, I don't want you. I want, you know, Nathan, and I fall in love with Nathan, and it's like, so he already has maybe kids from another, because that's, I thought that too. I was like, well, the one son definitely has to be like in his like 30s, 40s. Yeah. The one with the fake face is probably older. Yeah. Why have the fake face like that, you know?
Well, doing his leather face impersonation.
Yeah.
I did like Bill Moseley in this a lot. I mean, I know Bill Moseley stuff mainly from Rob Zombie films. You know, yeah. He does a lot of those. And he is a bit of a horror icon, Bill Moseley, especially for one today. And I remember doing, he took over for one of the roles in Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2 as one of them. So I thought, and to hear him sing, I thought, oh God, here he's going to sing. But he was okay, actually.
Yeah.
Pleasantly surprised. It's like, you know, I wouldn't buy an album of his, but he is with a grunge rock band, and it does fit this piece. So. He's got kind of that Billy Bob Thornton thing about him.
Yeah, I agree.
oddly attractive in a weird sort of way.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, I mean, I think that there's a lot to unpack in this, but I think it's quite interesting. It's quite a straightforward story. I think that it does feast your ears and mind and eyes at the same time, which I quite like.
Yeah. It's so. And I also like the technology from it because it is the future and you're kind of like, oh, like the hollow eye sockets of, you know, Mag, like that whole thing, like I gave her sight, but now I own you. But then she was able to project her mother. I love that scene. I love that was like really cool. And then even the paintings were like holographic images of her mom. And like, I love that they actually kind of play around with the technology of, and it's something that I think it almost gives it like a total recall or even, the third element.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. It gives it that kind of like, you know, feel, look and feel for it all. But yeah, I mean, it's interesting because I think there's elements to the story that replicate other types of operas, which make it sort of like I find opera is sometimes hard to hear sometimes, especially if it's like, again, a consistent aria and there's no words that are spoken. So you get some dialogue here and then the opera kind of takes you on this journey. And a lot of the songs are like fun and whimsical. So like when they're getting, what is the drug called? I forget what, but so the drug that they get, but there's like the whole, when he's extracting it, like there's a little dance between Shiloh and the grave robber, like there's these dances, right? So there's the dance between her and him. There's definitely the dance between Luigi and Pavi and the sister, you know, like them just playing around with each other. And I think it's like when you watch a movie like, or an opera like that, you need that upbeat to it, I guess. Mm-hmm. And it can't be so serious, but there are serious moments that make you sad, you know, when she's by herself and she's angry, and or the time that she loses her shit with her dad and she's like, you know, it goes from sweet 16 to like hard rock 17 year old, which I loved.
And seeing Joan Jett popping was great at that moment.
Yeah.
I think we covered two Joan Jett so far this season. Yeah, I have to say, I do like this film. It's one of those films, I say, the first time I saw it, I didn't really, I was like, okay. But this is like the third or fourth time I've seen it now. I watched it earlier this week. And it stayed with me, so I watched it again. It's like, every time I see it, I like it more and more. And there are some songs that now, it's not one of those musicals that you walk out of and you can hum a song.
Yes, I agree.
The only thing I can remember is the one that when Blind Meg shows up at Shiloh's house and her mom's singing, and can't chase the morning. Whatever that's going, with that opera thing going on with that backbeat going on between. I remember that, but I don't remember. I couldn't, like, if you asked me to, you know, sing any of the songs from it, I could probably sing that one rest of the tune there, because that kind of is on a loop, but I can't remember any of the songs. But well, I do like the soundtrack.
It's interesting because I think I was going to say the same thing. Like, I couldn't remember any of the songs, and usually that sets ill with me. Like, oh, so the story was okay, but the story was actually really good. The songs, I think if I watched it over again, it might set in a little bit. I think it's just like, it's almost like the songs are more like limericks, right? Because the way it rolls, it's not a refrain. And if it was a refrain, it was like it was like the song with the banter between Shiloh and the grave robber. It was them repeating each other. The grave, the grave, the grave, the grave. You know, and then they kind of like go into that.
Yeah.
You know, the bone, the bone, the bone, the bone, you know, it's like.
Yeah. And I think I think what else they did very, very well is that the music doesn't really take over the piece. It just fits into the piece. So therefore it's like, but you don't have like, you know, let's take the jukebox musical that tends to be the ones that be the huge money makers at the moment. They release a musical at the cinema now, or what tends to happen on Broadway every once in a while is they'll do these jukebox musicals. And so what you'll get like Mamma Mia or Rock of Ages or something of that ilk, or even the ones dealing with like Cher Tina Turner, Donna Summers, those kind of musicals. Yeah. And what we become used to in a very sad way is that, you know, it'll be like, so tell me, why isn't your relationship working? And then you'll get this pause, and then the person will look at the camera going, I don't want to talk. And like, what? And there's always like this weird pause before the song starts.
Yeah, before it goes. Because
like they're trying to shovel these like pop songs in. You know, and if you do go to the musical theater or you do see musicals, what happens is the music kind of like just fits in. It's like they'll be talking, all of a sudden they break out in the song, but it's not like there's this weird pause.
No,
but I think because of a lot of musicals that we see today are kind of, you know, Mamma Mia, and as I said before, they are jukebox musicals, but they're like putting pop songs into like this, some mostly bad scripts, really.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's the pop music that kind of sells it. Then they do like a mega mix at the end, so that way you're pretending that you had such a great time because now you're hearing all the hits done.
Yeah.
And this, you don't get that. This is kind of done in the old-fashioned way where you do get dialogue, but there's always the music kind of going on. And then when they break off in the song, it just feels natural in this world. But saying that, there's no complete songs in this world.
No.
You know, it's not like, you know, I'm going to sing verse, chorus, do a bridge, then the chorus, and then I'm going to fade out to the, you know,
and whatever. And some in this, someone can pick up a song that they were singing in another section of the movie that it's like, oh, that feels like that's part of that song. And it's just, it's very natural.
Yeah, and I noticed that each character has their own theme as well, as far as their music is concerned. There's this theme that's kind of playing with them. And then when they meet someone else, their theme's still going and the other person's theme's going at the same time. And then,
So
I think musically, I think they did a fantastic job with this as well. But yeah, I got to say that Repo's up there, actually. I think it's one of those things that you just kind of put on and you kind of just watch and just enjoy.
Yeah.
I haven't, I did take some of the songs and put them onto my playlist on my Spotify account, so they'll pop up on my
I feel like I have to go back and listen to it again, because I think that there's a couple songs, like I really liked the song at the very end with her and the dad when, you know, he's playing on the stage. That was a beautiful song, and like, I really liked that one. And then I liked the other one where, like you said, where the, I guess it'd be her godmother,
the Chase the Morning.
Yeah,
that's the one I put on my playlist.
And I like that one because I felt like it was her as herself singing, you know, Sarah Brightman. Sarah Brightman just to me is like, oh, and the other one I love too is where she kind of gives in at the end at the opera and she kind of kills herself, swan dives. She stabs her eyes out.
Yes, with her eye. That was quite disgusting, actually.
But
very operatic. And I have to say, what's also quite interesting, it does have that operatic storyline, that great big plot line. You know, in the end, it's got this very, very operatic finish without the Madame Butterfly arias going on or anything like that. Which, I quite like that as well. I did find it that there are some gory bits in it, though.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, you know.
Especially Repo Man with the guy when he has him in the chair in the beginning when you realize, oh, he's a Repo Man. I'm like, ooh. It's like cutting him open, taking out a liver.
Yeah, and then sticks his hand up inside of him and moves his mouth like he's a puppet.
Yeah. Oh, God. As I said, that character is probably one of the most interesting characters because it's as if he is like a dual personality, because with this daughter, he's so soft and kind and sincere and generous. But then when he's in this other persona, he's like ruthless and just and cunning, you know, and like, it's just interesting.
I also have to say the costume design is fabulous in this film.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I can see why this is doing a big deal with like audience participation and stuff like this, because it does lend itself to people dressing up and going to see this and reenacting it, like doing a Rocky Horror type of thing with it. Yeah. So I guess it does lend itself to that. Like you can just see like, oh, let's go see Rupert Madness and dress up, and you can just imagine how everyone's going to look seeing. Mm-hmm. So that's probably quite fun to see.
Well, it's interesting because it didn't do well in the box office. I mean, they spent almost $9 million and it made like 188 to almost 200,000. And you're just like, wow, that's horrible. But it's the cult, like when it comes to people who are cult fans, I'm now curious to see, in addition, what money has been made, because people are now like making it like they're Rocky Horror. Like, this is my Rocky Horror. Like, whereas, you know, our age, that's our Rocky Horror is our Rocky Horror, you know? So.
Yeah, I think that, I mean, I think it lends itself. I think it's going to grow and live on. And I think that it works in a lot of aspects. I'd be interested to see what the stage production of it looks like.
Yeah.
Because it started as a stage show, which I'd be very interested to see how that looks.
I still would like to see them continue the story, because again, there's so much still more there, especially with the Shiloh character to kind of play off of. And now that the secrets have all been told, right now it's sort of bringing things forward and into the surface, you know, so be interesting.
I mean, I'm not surprised it didn't make money. I mean, I can't see, you know, this. I mean, I could see this like being done for Netflix and being released on Netflix and doing very, very well. But I can't picture that because it's kind of a weird thing. It's one of those things that I think you have to discover, but I can't see a musical, you know, in quotations, fan falling in for this kind of film.
Yeah.
Per se. And I can't see goths going to see this kind of film. I'm going, oh, well, I'm really excited because I'm a goth. I want to go see this. Oh, I'm a musical fan. I'm really excited. I really want to see Repo, sort of thing. But I think it's one of those things that people would discover. And once they discover, they're going to love it. I think it's one of those films. But if it was that, if I saw a trailer for it at my cinema, I'd be like, oh, what's that?
Yeah, because it's interesting. I was actually looking up to see if I can find, that was 2001. The whole, I was going to say Jekyll and Hyde. It's not Jekyll and Hyde. What was a London slasher? Because Johnny Depp did a musical.
Sweeney Todd,
yeah. So I was wondering if it was around that same time, because Sweeney Todd had that. So was this sort of an ode or a nod to that, you know?
Well, I mean, Sweeney Todd has, you know, that's a Tony Award-winning show written by Stephen Sondheim.
Yeah.
The movie's okay. It would have been better.
It was 2007, so it was a year before this movie came out. So I was just curious to see.
That's probably how it got its money. It's like, well, that's doing well. That's kind of got, you know, Tim Burton's done this gothic Tim Burton mix on the film, so therefore this should do really well. Though I don't know if Sweeney Todd did that excellent anyway at the cinema.
No, it didn't do that well. No.
Because to be honest, it's an okay movie. Visually, it's fantastic. Sometimes your ears do bleed because Johnny Depp can barely carry a tune and must not even go into Helena Bonham Carter trying to carry a tune.
Yeah, exactly.
But then again, if you really want to see a great production of it, the original Broadway production with Angela Lansbury and Len Carew is available on DVD and Blu-ray. So, or if you really want to see a really fun version of it, there's Patti LuPone and Doogie Howser. What's his name?
Neil Patrick Harris.
Yeah, there's a production of them doing it on video now as well, because a lot of those musicals are now being released, the actual stage productions. So,
well, I guess it didn't do that bad, because it budgeted 50 and it made 152. So again, I think it did okay in that standard for that type of a movie.
I just can't see it ever being number one at the box office and wearing off sort of those. But I think as an independent feature, I think. But if, you know, I quite like things that are kind of like the underdog kind of films and enjoy, so.
I do too, and I like different. So that's, to me, like, this is something that was very different. And when you're watching it, again, it's kind of got this mix of the future, but then gothic. And so you got sort of a little bit of a sort of renaissance-ness about it in the way the style and how they dress. And even the whole, the way the communities interact with each other, you have like the, you know, the riffraff community, alley community versus like the elites who are in the audience, which I don't know if you like looked at that scene, how many people had like weird appendages of like making their face look normal, like the stitching and like their chins are like stapled up. I mean, it's like such a fascinating thing to watch, because you're like, oh, you see how much work went into this film. So.
Yeah, and I guess that brings us to Darren Bousman's follow-up, The Devil's Carnival, which was a 2012 musical horror film. It does star Sean Patrick Flannery, who looks a bit older in this, Brianna Evigan, Jessica Lowndes, Paul Sorvino again, Emil Autumn, and Terrance Zdunich returning. The film marks the second collaboration of Bousman and the writer-director and actor Terrance Zdunich. Their previous work, of course, was Repo that we just covered. The film does bring back several of the cast members of Repo. It does have Alexa Vega back and Bill Moseley and Nevik Ogre that do make an appearance for this. The interesting thing about The Devil's Carnival has Aesop's fables and other folklore at the core of its story, with the main characters each representing a fable. Franny's character, John, represents the grief and his due. Evigan's character, his Merrywood, represents the dog and its reflection. And Landis' character, Tamara, represents the scorpion and the frog, an animal fable that seems to have first emerged in Russia. So what we're going to do is cut to a commercial break, and we'll be back after this trailer.
Ah, you're just in time for a story.
Once upon a time, heaven was a tower tethered in its pride.
There are three acts scheduled for tonight's performance.
Thought the ink was dried, but hellish gardens flowered. Ivy to be climbed. Spread my filth, my wings, my weeds, my weeds.
I lost my son. I know your people are going to help me find him.
Answers wait inside, sir.
Did you see what those animals did to me?
Yes, they can be so cruel.
Liar!
You said you trusted me.
I trust you.
What is this place?
Who are you?
I'm the excuse you give when you cannot follow the rules.
666. 666.
Listen up, everyone. We're putting heaven out of business. Get ready for war.
Let me tell you a tale for a penny, one that you cannot hear anywhere else. Not anywhere else. I heard from a birdie a dozen and thirty a dozen and well. No, it never ends well. Let me spin you a yarn for a cent. Lord, would it not be a sin for you to deny yourselves a tale?
We're in the devil's carnival! Come to the devil's carnival! You can't help but fall! Devil's carnival!
Hello, welcome back to Literary License Podcast, and we're discussing The Devil's Carnival 2012. So, what did you think of this, John?
It was so short. Like, I actually wanted, so in conjunction to, you know, Repo Man, I think Repo was a little too long, and I think this is a little too short, because I wanted more, especially, like, you have the devil and God, so you have these characters that are very, it's very Greek. Right, like in my opinion, it felt very Greek. So these images, or put it, you know, apogees of these characters, and you know, in a circus, and I found it very. The Devil's Carnival didn't make me feel like they were in hell. They were maybe more in purgatory, and they're in this space where they were trying to figure out how to be judged, or which way to go, or which direction to go.
I felt that they were stuck in a really bad Rob Zombie film.
Yeah, that too. A purgatory.
Yeah, purgatory.
I just thought that it was short, but then, you know, some of the characters I really didn't get. Like, for instance, is it Miss Merrywood? Was she the girl that was wearing the dress, right? She was the one that was in the car that was getting, I guess, attacked. And then
Merrywood was...
Who was she?
That's right. That was her. Yeah, that's Merrywood. Yeah.
So yeah. I didn't really get her.
The two
character.
Girls are quite similar. So it's kind of like trying to figure out between the two girls were quite similar.
Yeah. And the other one who was a thief, right? So I get her. I get why she's sort of there. And I get why even the other guy who's there that... basically tries to kill himself. Like, I get those characters, but her character I didn't really get.
Well, she's a scorpion, and okay, there are three Aesop's fables, which are those Greek short stories that you remember reading in this, you know, Taurus and the Hare is an Aesop's fable. And they always have like this moral. And I mean, first of all, before they go into this purgatory hell fighting for the soul, which is, I think they're in a battle that they're not going to win anyway, it seems like. I don't think there's, you know, no matter what you do, you're not going to fight your fate. Your fate's going to be this, it seems like.
Yeah.
But with Merriwood's character, it's the scorpion and the frog. And the scorpion and the frog tale basically is that the frog thinks he can outsmart the scorpion. So he's talking to the scorpion sort of thing. And I guess it's kind of like the wide mouth frog, you know, it's like, I'm the wide mouth frog sort of thing. And, you know, what do you feed to your babies? And, you know, and he kind of jumps around and talks to all the different animals. But when he gets the scorpion's like really gentle with him and everything like that. And the tale of it is, just because someone's nice that of you, always prepare yourself for the sting in the tail, which means the tail. The nicest people are the ones who are most vicious.
Yeah, they'll stab you in the back. Yeah,
stab you in the back, and that's the story that we have here. And the thing is, I guess where this kind of goes wrong is that we get her in the car. We don't know why she's in the car. We got some guy saying we're thinking that she might be in an abusive relationship, though we're not. Yeah. You know, that's what it portrays itself to be, because we never learn anything beyond that. And then she gets sent down to hell because whatever happens. Because obviously she must have got shot in the face or shot because she had a gun and said, if you don't let me shoot you. And then she enters the hell or the devil's carnival. But you're kind of like wondering what her sin is.
Yeah. Like that's, you know? I didn't get. Like, is it gullibility? Like she's just gullible? Like, is it because
is she in love with the bad boy? Is that it? Yeah. She's always, you know, she's always throwing herself with bad men.
Always
like,
trusting bad men. Yeah.
You know, I mean, like a Jerry Springer episode.
And you're my baby daddy. Literally, I do like the choreography in the beginning between the three characters who are going to the Devil's Carnival, because how they each are like, no, no, no. It looks like it's almost like each scene is kind of following this, like you're saying, it's their path is set. Like this is what's going to happen. They're going to go to the Devil's Carnival, but each one of them are in the similar sort of path. Like the knocking on the door, the police are trying to get in to get the woman who's stealing things, and then the guy that's trying to get into her car is knocking on the door doing the same thing, and then I'm assuming it's the wife of the guy who's going to kill himself is knocking on the door. Like, what are you doing? So each one of them have people knocking at the door. Right. So I liked that. I thought that was very interesting and an interesting mechanism to use to kick it off. Cause it amped everything up very quickly. Cause now we're not just focusing on one character who is like killing himself. We're now hopping around and each one are sort of caught in this situation, you know? So I thought that was
interesting. Yeah. I have to then say that I think where it does come alive the most is when you have three of the carnies relating the Aesop's fable.
Yeah.
You know, you got the clown girl, which I don't know what her name is, because unfortunately it was really hard to make out what these...
It was a painted doll.
The painted doll gives the story of the frog and the scorpion. And that's really effective because it kind of puts, okay, this is what this story is about. And then you add the other one, when they're beating the girl because she's the one that's
the magician or the twin.
The twin gives that story out. And that's fantastic. And the hobo clown giving the other story. Yeah. And that kind of flushes it out. But I had something to say, some of this music's really annoying.
Oh, yeah.
There's a lot of it. It's just like...
Agree.
I mean, nothing... I mean, I think any time that you're going to try to vocalize carnival music is probably a no-go area. And there wasn't a coherency, and there is a very kind of cheap Hollywood soundstage feel to this film. Mm-hmm. I didn't really care for anybody.
Yeah.
I did think that the hobo clown was fantastic. He was excellent, and he's with a group called Slipknot. He's the lead singer from that. Gothic horror.
Oh yeah. Oh my gosh. I didn't know that. Okay.
And you did get, you know, and there are some individually, if you took this person out and just showed their performance, they're very, very good. Everyone's performance is very, very good, but there's something that doesn't really gel here. And I find my mind wandering a little bit. I wasn't that invested in any of them. I mean,
I was going to say, I just feel like there was no, they should have had a constant narrator, because I even feel like Lucifer kind of comes in midpoint and you're like, oh, he's narrating these stories to this kid. But it's like a weird sort of like, I'm going to tell you how all the stories end. And you're like, okay, well, where were you in the beginning? And then it's just weird. Yeah.
And then of course, for our listeners, this does have a sequel to it, which is a longer film called Alleluia, the Devil's Carnival. I suggest that if you do like this, watch it. I couldn't finish it. I had the middle of it. I go, I don't have time for this. I really don't have time for it. I just couldn't get into it. And that's basically the same characters, and hell is coming to heaven to take the battle to them, and coming having to deal with its own shit.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, I guess it's interesting, but I couldn't get into it. But with this, I mean, there are a couple good things in it where it's just like, you know, it's like, you know, when it is mentioned, when Sean Patrick Flanner's character goes, you know, why did you take my son? And I like when the devil said, God takes the children. I only take you if you do something bad. Oh, and I thought that was very interesting. It's like, oh, okay, well, that's good. And there's some like little snippets in here that are really, really good.
Yeah.
But everything kind of gets lost and it gets a bit muddled. And, you know, I guess maybe if they did it on location, maybe like on the set of American Horror Story Carnival season.
Yeah.
Or gave it like a specific look, maybe a 30s look, or give it a maybe, you know, if you want to go for a futuristic look, give it a futuristic look, but stick to a look.
Yeah.
And stick to a more strong storyline, maybe. And, you know, and maybe work on your music a little bit. So therefore, because the music is kind of weird, because it's what we had like when I was talking about the Jukebox musical. It's kind of jarring. You kind of got to talk.
And then we're going to go.
Song.
Like, yeah, what? I know.
It's like, you know, where Repo kind of blended everything together. So it's like, even when they were singing, you had to kind of remind yourself that they were singing because there's kind of like this music thing going through it. This kind of has some really jarring thing. And then when they did start singing, it just kind of felt, everything just felt a bit jagged.
Yeah.
And I don't know if that was through bad editing or this is the look or the sound that they wanted to present for this. I really don't know what audience this was for.
Yeah, I don't think it was meant to be even technically an opera, even though there are elements to an opera that were like, again, the Greek fable and certain things like that. But it was almost like sometimes there was too much dialogue. And then you get to a point to where then there's dialogue. And like you said, you know, I'm where? And then it's like, purgatory. And then it gets like this weird, you know, like music starts up and you're like, what is going on? And it's like, and we're in a musical now, you know, and you're like, what?
I mean, it's quite a shame. I for me, it was quite interesting to see Brianna Evigan. She's one of these names that was tooting around. And Brianna Evigan is Greg Evigan's daughter, you know, from BJ and the Bear and My Two Dads.
Yeah.
The really good looking one, it's his daughter. And she's kind of one that's like, she was always appearing in like, you know, up and coming and all this other stuff. And, you know, I've never seen her in anything. So it was interesting to see what she looked like and what she could do. I spent most of my time looking at Sean Patrick Flannery going, God, you're getting older.
Yeah.
Sort of thing. Cause he always had kind of that Brad Pitt kind of look about him, didn't he? Whereas, you know, not anymore. You know?
Yeah.
I mean, still a nice looking guy, nothing against him, you know, anything like that. He's still nice looking. He just looks middle-aged now.
Yeah.
And you look at the talent that's involved, and there is a lot of good talent here, but I don't think it was just very utilized. And I just, you know, now maybe I'm thinking that Repo, the genetic opera, started off as a stage musical before they turned it into a film. And this one was basically written for just for a film. And they said that they made, if enough people Patreon them, they make a sequel, which obviously they did because we did get a sequel that's way too long. And since we're not going to be discussing that, I'll stop now before I go on a tangent. But maybe if it was workshopped and they could have like worked out the kinks and then, so therefore it's kind of like, but they didn't. And so probably what they've done, and you kind of get this with Rocky Horror Picture Show has a, not a sequel or a prequel, but an equal called Shock Treatment. And at the time that that came out, it wasn't, you know, Rocky Horror was a musical. And so by the time it went to the screen, they were able to work out all the kinks and figure out what they wanted to use. Shock Treatment, the film, which we'll probably be covering next year, basically what they were saying was that, of course, it wasn't the cult hit that they thought it was going to be or had the hit that they thought they were going to do because of Rocky Horror. But what they basically had was a film that the writers, the songwriters, stuff like this, said that, you know, they wrote the song, but because they didn't rehearse, you know, they knew what they wanted, but they didn't have that part where you're like workshopping this in and figuring out how they're going to work inside the scripts and everything like this.
Yeah.
That was one of the reasons the movie doesn't work. Now, today, Shock Treatment is a huge cult following now, and it's probably better than its predecessor because it was way ahead of its time. But you can see that if you went to solve this, that there's not that flow in the thingy because they didn't workshop it. They didn't know what songs were going to work, what songs are not going to work within the confines.
Yeah.
And, you know, back to Devil's Carnival, this is what we tend to get. We got things that don't really work within the confines of the story. So we kind of get like a glorified student film.
Yeah. It's also, you have nothing that you hit the nail on the head in the beginning, which was like, you're not attached to any of the characters. So you don't really don't care. So like, you know, each one of the characters where they're being judged, right? It's like, you don't feel bad for any of them. You kind of just indifferent to what their circumstances are and their punishments. You don't really, it's like a Devil's Carnival. You would think like, you know, what was her name? Wick, you know, you think after stealing things and being whatever, her punishment is she's stripped down and she's whipped. Well, some people actually like that. So that's not really a punishment. So it was kind of like, I thought like, oh, is she gonna, like, because she steals everything, are they gonna eventually take her clothes, but then take her skin and then take, like, it's like, then it's like, ooh, this is kind of graphic. This is a little like jarring. And now I might feel a little bad for her because even though she has been a thief, you know, there's nothing. And even, you know, the girl that gets stabbed, she gets, I guess, turned into a toad. And then the whole story with the toad and the scorpion is stinging the toad. Like, I was like, I'm so confused. Like, what is going on? Like, it just was, what's going on? But I really don't care. Like, right. You know, I'm like, what's going on? But who cares about these characters?
You're just watching it. And that's all you're doing. You're just watching it. There's no emotion whatsoever, I found.
Yeah. And even the father who's missing the kid, you're kind of like, oh, well, what's going on? Why are you missing the kid? Every time you got a little bit.
What happened to the kid? Do we know?
Yeah, I don't know. I think he lost him. I don't know. Like, we never know.
I watched this film twice and I still don't know what happened to him. Why the kid was lost? Did he die? Was he supposed to be watching him and he died? That's why he wanted to commit suicide.
Like, did he drown the kid? Like, what? Like, I don't know what, like, I didn't get that either. So it's like, again, how do I feel bad for someone when I don't even know why they're feeling bad? Like, why, how do I, you know?
Yeah, we know he's trying to commit suicide, but is he trying to commit suicide because the kid was taken? Did he murder the kid? Or did the kid, you know, was playing in the street? Or did the kid come home and get hit by a school bus? Who knows?
And then when we get
we see the kid running around and he's missing a shoe.
Yeah, and we get close because we get to a point where the end, you're kind of getting, you know, when the devil says, like, I don't take kids, I take people who did bad things. And then I forget what he says, and I kind of gets him off the hook. And I'm like, really? That's it? Like, seriously?
And then he comes out of the toy box in heaven, or God, or Paul Savino's playing God. So he comes out of the toy box, and Paul Savino's looking at him like, what in the hell are you doing here? And that's the end of the film, pretty much. And okay, well, yeah, you know, like you were talking about the whipping scene. I mean, they could have really done a Mel Gibson last, you know, Christ thing on her. You know what I mean? Yeah. You know, like maybe the Greedo porn, or do a Hellraiser where they beat her and then they tear off their skin, like you were saying, or something. And the thing is, they're calling this thing a music horror fantasy. Yeah, there's no horror in this whatsoever.
No.
There's nothing scary. There's no sense of malice. There's no sense like, oh my God, I'm on the edge of my seat because I don't know what's going to happen to them. And it does surprise me that it's got an hour and a half sequel.
Yeah,
I don't know why.
I know.
I mean, I like, you know, maybe I mean, people raised the money for, there must have been people who liked this.
I think there must have been people who wanted answers to questions, because there's a lot of questions for this film. And it's like, if you're not, especially you end it with, okay, let's get ready. We're going to go to heaven. We're going to, why? Because we're going to war. Like, that's a big, okay, well, what's happened? Oh, now it's over. Great. Now it's over? Like, really? Like, what the hell?
I mean, literally. You read what the critics have written about this. 4 out of 5 stars.
I know. It's, yeah.
Yeah. Subversive and infectious. You know who I think is? I think it's this, you know, those people who kind of like go and see a, you know, one of those really pretentious art films, and they walk away and they think, oh my God, this is
best like, thing ever, you know.
Best thing ever. This has really changed my life. It's like, it just shows what the mythos of life is like. And without the mythos of life, our lives are nothing. I really felt, it hit me to the core. And meanwhile, you're looking at it as like a piece of string hanging.
You're like, really?
Yeah. It's like a piece of string hanging from the ceiling and a pail connected to it, swinging. And you're like, oh.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I can't, there's not one song I would want to listen to on here again.
Yeah, yeah, I'm the same. I think I definitely want to go back to Repo and listen to those songs. It's something, I might not remember them, but I definitely want to listen again because I liked the flow of them. I think this was as if someone's just trying to read poetry to you, but singing the poetry to you because it's very haiku.
Yeah.
Right, so it's like blah 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 blah, and it's like it eventually became manamana, manamana. Like there's like literally,
it's like Laurie Anderson without the talent.
Yeah, yeah, serious.
I'm a dog, and I'm walking on a string. Yeah, it does lend itself to some of this music, and the thing is, it's very disappointing because the music that they have in Repo, he did a fantastic job on that. And every time I watch that, something else pops out at me. And there's a lot I like. You know, I like, you know, the narrator at the beginning, and you go, and we'll all wind up in a pine little box. A pine little box. A pine little box.
That's what I like. Yeah.
And I like that. And I like, you know, even when Paul Sorvino kind of goes in with his operatic voice, it just kind of all works. And the music, and there's like little, though I can't sing a full song, there are little melody lines and little lines that kind of run through my head every once in a while with Repo. Mm-hmm. Here, I'm glad that none of it does, because it does sound like screeching on a blackboard, some of the music. It's not melodic. It doesn't... I know that the three songs that do work the best are the ones that I mentioned earlier, which kind of like basically takes what you've just seen and kind of puts it into some sort of context.
Yeah.
And I think that the people who deliver those are fantastic. Those three artists delivered are fantastic.
Yeah, the painted doll. I mean, she was amazing. I would say I didn't care for the song, but as a character, she was definitely creepy. But again, her with all the other characters, it was like so out of place. It was like this. Mm-hmm. It's like Annabelle with like like the Care Bears. Like, I don't know. Like, it's just it was so out of place. Like, so out of character.
I mean, of course, we did get our token dwarf in there. Of course, you need a token dwarf.
Yeah.
You know, he doesn't sing. Or if he does, he's mouthing words in the background. Yeah, and the hobo guy, I found the hobo guy actually, you know, between the character you just said and the hobo, I found my eye was drawn to them. And I actually, they're probably the only two times that I was actually drawn to it, and actually was a little bit mesmerized by the performances. The comedy doesn't work.
I think
their comedy moments, you know, with the magician, which is Bill Moseley coming back from Repo, he's playing the magician here, and it's quite a shame because normally he's quite enigmatic. No matter what he does, he'll play these off-kilter characters and you can't get your face away from him because you're just watching him, and he might be in the background, but you're still kind of drawn to him. Here, not so much. He's kind of there and you're thinking, well, okay. Yeah. it's like going to a comedian and everyone's laughing and you're sitting there going, I just don't get it.
I don't find it funny. Like, yeah, you're like, I just don't find it funny. Yeah.
Don't find it funny. Sorry. I guess that's me, like Ricky Gervais. I just don't find it funny. I don't understand. So I guess we pretty much torn that film apart, and we won't be reviewing this song. So, you know, if you really want to kill us and torture us, make sure you go on to our website at www.llpodcast or send me an email. The episode that gets the most votes will mean the one that we will we'll do again. So we have to watch it over and over in our own.
Oh, God, please don't. Yeah. But that'll be our purgatory, right? Yeah, our devil's carnival. Yeah.
I mean, for 54 minutes, it felt like the longest movie I've ever seen.
Yeah.
It was as long as Braveheart was for me. Or
I mean, it was, again, I don't felt that it was long. It was watchable. It was just like, I'm indifferent. Like, I didn't have like strong feeling towards it. I was just kind of like, oh, interesting. You know, it's sad when you're like, you're more infatuated with the costuming and the makeup, you know, with the movie than anything else. Like, you know, the Lucifer painting and all, like the paint and everything and the way he looked. I was like, oh, that's good makeup, you know, but that's all that's drawing me to this story, then that's sad, you know.
But even the devil's makeup wasn't fantastic. It was typical devil makeup, you know, and you could see where, you know, you can see where the break is between the skin and where he had the horns on, you know what I mean? So they didn't even blend that together. It was sort of very cheaply done, I guess. I know they didn't have much money, but I think you could have done more with what you had, especially since we're dealing with people who are professionals and they're used to having these big multi-budget, you know, films. I mean, he's directed five Saws. You know, he did Repo Genetic Opera, which has a fantastic look to it, and makeup design and stuff like this. And I just think, I just think, you know, if this was the first film he ever did, maybe I feel a bit differently, but
this was after what he just,
We saw what he did with Repo, and you're seeing this, and it's like, this is a misfire.
Yeah, it's like, again, it probably was just this thought, like, ooh, I can do this soliloquy of Greek, you know, stories, and I can mash it together, and I can put it in a carnival, and all of that, again, are great ideas, but you have to also make the characters likable. You have to thread the needle, if you will, with where the trajectory, where the characters are going, because even if they ended it the way they began it, where each one of them was, their fate was kind of deemed, and they all were replicative in some ways, and they're being judged. And you're thinking, oh, if it's going to be the same way in the beginning, they all were going on that same path, but that one person did something different. And so, like, these two got their fate, and then this one didn't, right? And then that would have at least made something like, oh, this is very interesting. It just brought them to the circus, and it kind of left them cleaning up elephant poop.
Yeah, I have to agree with you. Yeah, and I mean, to be honest, I'd much rather have him do like the sequel that we're expecting for Repo, maybe even if it was done on a cheaper thingy. I think it would have been more interesting. I mean, he had the same cast back.
Yeah, I also think it's like
the only person missing is Paris Hilton.
Yeah, I think a lot of people would see it, and I think nowadays CGI isn't as expensive as what it used to be. So you could definitely create a world where you could just use a lot of CGI and bring in the talent to, you know, in the story.
I mean, I will give it to, I do like the fact that he did use Aesop's Fables. I thought that was quite good. I liked Aesop's Fables. It's quite good. Those little tales, you know, those little whimsical tales that had that, you know, the sting in the tail, the moral to the tale. Yeah. And I do like that. And I think that's probably why I like the three people who sang the songs, because they stuck to the tale sort of thing.
Yeah.
So I guess we might as well go and find out which film we like the most and give our final thoughts. So,
which of
these two films did you like the most?
I loved Devil's, no, just kidding. I obviously am going to choose Repo. I think it was a very interesting character, because I think it's like you sympathize with the dad, and you sympathize with what he is doing for his daughter, but then at the same time you kind of have these little twists and turns. I definitely think the music, I want to go back and listen to more, because as Keith was saying, it's some of it starting to pop back into my head again, and I want to actually explore that more. Unfortunately, Devil's just kind of, yeah, it's like stale popcorn. You just got to throw it out. You know, it wasn't what it could be. It could have been.
Yeah, me, Repo, Genetic Opera. Every time every time I watch it, I like it more and more. It's one of those things that just grows on me. And it's, I think it's one of those films I would actually share with people as well. Like, oh, do you want to see something interesting? And just hear what people's different takes on it.
Yeah.
You know, I was thinking, like, because Vicky's not with us, I thought, oh, I bet you Vicky would have enjoyed this if she was.
I think she would have. I think she would have thought it was very trippy, but I think she would have liked it. Yeah.
Yeah. And I think that's what I quite, you know, I like this. I like the story, and I am interested in the story. I do want to see the sequel. I want to know what happens to Silo, and I want to know what happened to those weird, freaky characters that, you know, that lived past the end, and what happens to Jenko. I'm interested. It was just kind of weird because if I, you know, that's what, you know, so obviously I quite enjoy it because I'm actually keen on seeing where they're going.
I think, and it's like even the brothers and the sister, the three of them, just them battling each other could be almost like one of these where they're always trying to one-up each other to gain control of the company and sort of maybe giving some context to who they are as characters. Because, you know, they're messed up, but I mean, some of it isn't their father's fault, right? What turned them into these people, you know?
Money. Maybe
money, greed.
Mendendez brothers.
Yeah, pretty much. I think Paris's character was probably the most sadistic because of the fact that she just loved to get that high and be cut up, you know, or cut people. I was like, ooh.
Yeah. I do like Repo. Devil's Carnival, yeah, it just left me cold. I'm not sure if I'm glad that I saw it, but I experienced it.
Yeah.
You know, would I go back to it? Not really, but the funny thing about it is kind of like, I think this is going to be like my Gladiator or my Dances with Wolves or Braveheart, which are these films that everyone talks about how great they are, and I just don't get it.
Yeah.
And every about 3 or 4 years, I'll watch it again and figure out, see maybe I'm missing something.
Mm-hmm.
Or it's like The Piano. It's like, you know, The Piano is a brilliant film. And for me, I watch The Piano, and I don't understand why Holly Hunter went with Harvey Keitel, who has no penis, and she picked him over Sam Neill. I just don't understand it. And to me, Devil's Carnival is like that. I just don't get it.
And you'll get people who do analysis on that movie and be like, oh, and this is what you, I found this exploration of this. And you're like, oh, I totally didn't see that. So, you know, I think it's just what you see within a film, you know?
Yeah. I mean, maybe, you know, maybe you can't take the trailer out of the boy, like that's what's happening. So yeah.
Well, now that we have taken you into the deepest depths of the gothic aria, you should be pitch perfect and ready to go for our next episode, where we will be discussing the 1987 film Dario Argento's opera. But if you feel like you just can't find the melody, or maybe you're a little tone deaf, head on over to our website, llpodcast.com, to find all of our social and podcast platforms, as well as listen to all of our past episodes, become a patron, and read our reviews of books to screen and everything in between. I guarantee you it will bring music to your ears. As always, I'd like to thank you for downloading, sharing, and liking the Literary License Podcast. Now it's time for Keith and I to get out there and collect a few organs. Whistle while you work. Bye, folks.
Bye. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
the saga. Sometimes I wonder how we ever got here. Old grudges, scorned lovers. Sometimes I wonder why we all don't move on. 'Cause we all end up in a tiny pine box. A mighty small drop in a mighty dark plot. And the mighty fine print hastens the trip to our epilogue.
Epilogue?
But the little girl fled, and the king is dead, and the castle is left for the taking. But Jinko may survive if it undergoes surgery. 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 Surgery.
Surgery. Surgery. Surgery. Repo Man.
Forgotten. And Jinko will live on under new management. Me.
Pray he never comes knocking at the door. Say that you once spun a heart on new cornea.
Amber Sweet, ladies and gentlemen, Amber Sweet. I can't hear you. I can't fucking hear you, you fucking peasants!